I'd like to welcome everybody here today on this bright and sunny day. If we have any visitors, please stay after for just a minute as we can say hello to you and tell you a little bit. Happy birthday salute this week to Joshua Wood, who's on the 7th. Covered dish luncheon is today, immediately following the service. So please stay for that. And if you didn't bring any food, there's always plenty of food, so please go along with the stay. Last leaders prep session is today, and also on the 19th from noon until 2. There's a whole list of people in our prayers. Please glance over that and keep those people in mind. Nellie Trent is in the hospital, and they said Betty Pascu is not feeling well today. Our sympathy goes out to Donna Shirley Davis and family in the recent passing of Don's brother, John Davis. Also, I don't know if some of you may remember from Parkman Road, Eddie Lomax has passed away, which I believe he was been living in Columbus lately. But please keep that family in your prayers also. His services are also in Columbus.
That would be your wife. If anybody knows my wife.
Oh, okay.
His real name was Eddie, but his. We always called him Dwight.
Okay, so I'm not sure if you could hear that, but they called him Dwight Lomax. His real name is Dave. Please keep that in mind. Also, some good news here, if you didn't realize it, on March 12th, we get to turn our clocks forward on that. So that's nice to hear. And here's, each week they have the little getting to know our brothers and sisters. I'll read this, and you can try to figure out who it is. As a member of our Cortland church family, I am a newer addition to our congregation. I was born in Hubbard and have recently remarried. I used to be a licensed beautician and an avid bowler with a 162 average, and I currently enjoy embroidery. I almost always sit on the sanctuary on the left side facing the cross. And that's all I have. Does anybody have anything that I missed? Please bow with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we'd like to come to you thanking you so much for all you've blessed us with. Thank you for our health and our families and all the good things that you've given us. Help all those, Lord, that are on our prayer list that are not feeling well and sick and families that are mourning. Please be with them and comfort them and help them through their hard times. Thank you, Lord, for letting us live in a country where we have freedom so that we can worship you freely. And please help guide our new leaders in our country to guide the country in the right direction. We thank you for all you've given us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Begin this morning with number 233. Page 233. We'll be singing the first four verses.
Gracious man. we are so humbled when we think about the plan of salvation. How you could watch from heaven as your Son became a willing sacrifice on our behalf. How he was misused and beaten and spit upon and made fun of and then died on our behalf. That we have your grace and your mercy. And we are so thankful. And I pray, dear Heavenly Father, this morning as we assemble together in your church here, that you would be with Vic as he delivers the word to us this morning. May we willingly receive the word. May we apply it to our lives. And when we face trials and temptations, that we would have the strength because of our relationship with you to resist. And we know, dear Heavenly Father, that as we serve you, that oftentimes we fail and we come short. But I pray that we would learn from those mistakes that we make, and I pray that they would strengthen us and make us better servants to you in the future. And we can understand what our brothers and sisters go through sometimes in temptation. I pray, dear Heavenly Father, that you would be with this country. I'm so thankful that we live in this country, that we do, that we have the religious freedoms that we do, that we can join together, that we can worship you without fear of being harmed or persecuted because of our beliefs. And I pray, dear Heavenly Father, that we would always take advantage of the opportunities that we have to assemble together and worship you and study your word. I pray for our young men and women who are serving this country, that are serving on foreign soil and in harm's way and battling against the war on terrorism. I pray that you would keep them safe, and I pray that you would return them home to their families and to their loved ones. I pray at this time, dear Heavenly Father, for the ones who are sick. I pray that you would be with Nellie Trent, that you would be with all of those who have medical problems and issues, and I just pray that it would be healed, that you would touch them, and that you would heal them as only you can do. I offer up a special prayer at this time for the Davis family, the Lomax family, and the recent loss of loved ones. I pray, dear Heavenly Father, that the relationship that they have with you, that they would find comfort, and that they would find peace in this difficult time in their lives. We thank you so much for the blessings that we enjoy because of our relationship with you. And I pray that we would be able to put our personal wants and our agendas aside and be willing to be used as servants in any way that you see fit. And I pray that we would be a humble servant just as Jesus was, that we can be of service to you in your kingdom and spreading your word to the lost and to the erring. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
During our offering this morning, we'll be singing number 238. That white sermon will be on the screen. Now, to prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper, 374. 374. We'll be singing the first and the third verses.
There is now found.
Thank you.
again to commemorate Jesus' sacrifice upon the cross for the remission of our sins. We have talked about it many a times, the amazing pain and suffering that he went through being completely guiltless without sin, and about the great love that God had for us and Jesus' love that he would be willing to sacrifice himself to endure the physical, emotional, and spiritual pain that he went through. But let us also remember the grace of God that forgives us as we partake of his death and burial and the resurrection that he went through and that we go through as Christians, and that we commemorate this each week with partaking of these emblems here. Help us to remember that God's grace saves us because each one of us is unworthy through some manner, whether it's sins we commit or deeds that we should do and don't do, or just the fact that we fall short in knowledge and wisdom and understanding. But God loves us and he forgives us, so let us remember his grace. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal Father, we thank you for this day, for bringing us together here on this first day of the week to commemorate your son's death and his burial and his resurrection. Help us to remember that this applies to us, and these emblems symbolize his flesh that was broken upon the cross. So bless it as we break it, bless it as we partake of it. Bless us and let us do so in accordance with thy will and within approval of your, in your sight, in Christ's name.
That is great. Almighty Father, let us also remember all the many blessings you give to us besides the opportunity we have together here as Christians and worship you. That we live in a land of freedom where we have the freedom of conscience to attend church as we see without molestation, without hindrance. That we are blessed by knowing the Bible above all other people of previous ages. That we have the freedom to understand it, to study it. That we have the freedom of this nation where we can go out and believe what we like. That we can serve you freely. That we have all the many physical blessings as well. That we all have jobs or incomes. That we have the freedom to live our lives freely and to believe what we like. In Christ's name, amen.
You are the words and the music. You are the song that I sing. You are the melody. You are the harmony. Praise to your name I will bring. You are the Lord of lords. You are the mighty God. You are the King of all kings. Look how I give back to you the songs that you gave. You are the song that I sing. You are the words and the music. You are the song that I sing. You are the melody. You are the harmony. Praise to your name I will bring. You are the Lord of lords. You are the mighty God. You are the King of all kings. You are the song that I sing.
Our song invitation this morning will be number 911. It will be on the screen. Now before our scripture reading, lesson number 202.
Oh,
Good morning. We ask that you stand for the reading of God's word. We read from 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17. We read from the King James Version. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new.
Thank you, Rob. That song we just sang, when I hear that, I want to break out my novel voice. Are we having a kids class? Yes, kids class. Who's got the pieces? That's the title of this morning's lesson. You know, we've all experienced in our lives sayings that have been passed from one generation to the next. For the most part, we just take those sayings, well, grandma told mom, mom told me, so I guess they must be true. We often refer to them as old wives' tales, but we could just as easily say old husband tales or family lore. If something's repeated enough, people just take for granted that it must be true. So I have a couple of examples. Ouch! You need to put hydrogen peroxide on that. I remember hearing that. You put the hydrogen peroxide on and it bubbled up. You think, oh, it's doing its job. And now we find out it's not doing its job. Putting hydrogen peroxide on the cut is actually worse because it harms the cells in the surrounding area and the healing process can actually take longer. 60 years of knuckle cracking. Now, we've all been told as kids, don't crack your knuckles. You'll get arthritis, you'll hurt them. Well, there's been a lot more research done on this than we first realized. There's a doctor named Donald Unger who for 60 years, he cracked the knuckles on his left hand and never bothered his right hand. He did the experimented on himself. And after 60 years, he looked at his left hand and his right hand, no appreciable damage at all. So cracking your knuckles is not going to cause you physical injury. The primary negative impact on cracking your knuckles is the annoyance it causes the people around you. Another one? Oh no! Don't swallow your gum. Because it takes 7 years to digest. I remember as a kid, the fear I had, the gum was piling up somewhere inside me. You know, as a kid, you chew your gum and the flavor's gone and you're not thinking about it and something distracts you and the next thing you know, oh no, I got another piece piling up in there. Now, there's been a lot of research done on this as well. Colonoscopy research has been done to find out how long it takes gum to exit the body. And it turns out, I'll be just fine. Here's one more. If someone tosses a penny off the Empire State Building and it hits a pedestrian on the head, it'll penetrate his skull and kill him. That defies the laws of physics. If you take in the weight of a penny, it's resistance to the air, and it's accumulated kinetic energy, it's going to hurt, but it's not going to penetrate your skull. It's not going to get the velocity or gain the velocity of a meteor. Okay. So, our point is there are certain things we've just learned to accept. We just accept them without question. There are certain things we just go along with. We kind of live our lives sometimes according to these things. We may even pass them on to our children, to the next generation. We find these things are really reinforced from people around us because we're not just saying it, we're hearing it from elsewhere. As we can see, we're told a lot of the same things. So it must be true. Everybody says it.
and we spend our lives pouring hydrogen peroxide on our wounds and abstaining from the fun of knuckle cracking for no real reason. Now that was a little milk. Now let's get into a little meat. What if we just accepted some things that have had much more significant implications? What if we've just gone along with some things? We just believe some things because, well, we've been told that. And it's been reinforced by the culture around us. Much more dire ramifications may be involved. I remember a teen class I had years ago where the teens asked me, why do people believe so many different things? Why are there so many different denominations in Christianity? You know, why is it? Could it be that too many of us just accept and go along with what we're told and not check things out for ourselves? This is going to be the main point of our study. The story from Luke that all of us can relate to and gain confidence through. A story that gives hope when there doesn't seem to be any. The story that defines Paul's statement, when I am weak, then I am strong. If we study the ministry of Jesus, here are some of the things we will find. He spent a lot of his time teaching as a rabbi. He spent a significant amount of his time debunking the myths that people had been taught about God, about faith, and about himself. A lot of what he did was to say, you've heard it said, but I'm going to tell you something different. I know you've been taught to look at it this way. I'm going to give you a new way of looking at it. He came confronting false beliefs about faith, about religion, about God, about himself, that many people had just accepted. So let's perk our ears up here. This is important. Many of the spiritual leaders of Jesus' day made the focus the outside. Their focus was the outside. To them, that's what it meant to follow God. It was like, get your act together by doing the following. Keep up appearances. And you follow the right rules. And you maintain and keep the rituals. Then Jesus comes along and he says, look, I know you've been taught that it's what's on the outside. That's not what it's about. It's what's on the inside. And then what's on the inside comes out. It's an inside-out way of following God. It's completely different. He was changing everything. However, many of us look at faith like the old Jews. So we have taught ourselves to keep track of how we're doing on the outside. We have learned how to keep up appearances, to make everybody know we have a smile on our face, and that everything is good and we don't have any problems. And God says, look, people may look at the outside, but I look at the heart. God looks at the inside. Back in Jesus' day, that was hard for the people to accept. It was a total change. It was a total reversal of thought. It was all about change. He truly turned the world upside down, and we could say he turned it inside out. Bring the inside out. This was even an issue in the temple back then. Some felt unwelcome, or they just were not good enough to take part in worship. They even made the way people dressed an issue. The leadership would get offended if someone was too expressive in their worship. Sound a little familiar? I can remember back when Deb and I first became Christians, and I didn't wear a tie to morning services, I got some frowns. And I was even one time confronted by an elder that I'm not supposed to wear sneakers in the worship service. And if someone would shout, amen, during the sermon, you know, you kind of look at it, or someone raised their hands during the prayer, which is okay, but we just don't do that. Back in Jesus' time, people felt like in order to worship, they had to have it all together. That they couldn't have any problems, and that their families weren't struggling, and they had nothing hidden in the closet. The result was that the house of God had become a place where it wasn't safe to talk about your struggles, or to deal with one's hurts or one's failures. Hope we never get like that. The people back then were made to believe that some things that weren't true about Jesus. They were believed that something, you know, they were taught things that weren't true about Jesus. And Jesus addressed some of these commonly held untruths. That instead of looking like you have it all together, he wants authentic worship. Instead of carefully observing all the religious rituals, he wants a close relationship. Instead of acting more righteous than you really are, what he wants is brokenness. That's the key word for today, brokenness. A word not used much today. We live in a culture that's been, well, we're a throwaway society. Just look at what we toss out on a weekly basis. Each successive generation is getting farther and farther away from the skills of fixing things. I had an uncle who's a TV repairman, and he taught my brothers and I how to repair TVs. As kids, we would actually fix people's television sets. So how many, look at the yellow pages. How many TV repairmen do you see today? How many cobblers do you see? We don't fix things anymore. When things break, we throw them away. We don't value repairing and fixing or making things like new again. We live in a throwaway culture. If you visit the Empire State Building and go to an observation deck, you'll notice some scopes up there. Those scopes you can look out to get a better look at a city. Jesus gives us this kind of different lens to look at broken things. Instead of throwing away, let's look at these broken things differently. Jesus says, in effect, come here. I want you to look at the world through my eyes, through my scope. Look at this person through the lens I'm looking at them through. Unlike us, when Jesus sees broken, he sees beautiful. He sees something of value. When God sees broken, he sees beautiful. We're going to look at an example in Luke 7. This is a story that really brought about today's lesson. I find it amazing that we can read through several times, and each time something new seems to jump off at us from the pages. We'll read it, we'll study it, think about it, and then we'll go back to it, and then, ooh, something new pops up. A new understanding that we missed in the past. That's what makes God's Word so exciting. So we want to just share the story this morning rather than read it. I encourage all of us when we get home to read these verses, and we'll get to them. And then see what you discover in these verses. Now you'll find the story in Luke chapter 7, verses 36 through 49. Luke 7, 36 through 49. In this story, Jesus has been invited over to a house of Simon, who's a Pharisee. He's a religious leader. As a religious leader, it was Simon's duty to invite the visiting rabbi over for a meal. Jesus arrives at Simon's house, and we can see from what's not in this story and what's in it that Simon didn't have his heart in this at all. He doesn't really want Jesus there. He's uncomfortable with it. When Jesus walks in, Simon doesn't offer him a greeting, doesn't shake his hand or like we do today, or doesn't, like they did then, kiss him on the cheek. When the time to eat comes around, Simon doesn't have the feet of Jesus washed, which was the most common thing to do for a guest in one's house, or at least give the guest water so they could clean their own feet. This wasn't done. If a guest was a special guest of honor, olive oil would be presented to anoint the hair with. Simon did none of these things. Jesus comes in, sets down, and Simon doesn't honor him. We read verse 37 that this woman comes in, and things start to get a little awkward, to say the least. We read that she is a sinner. This term sinner is used in this probably has a connotation that she was a prostitute, and that she was well known in the community as being that. At least she was considered a sinner. We can be sure that those that gathered at the meal, other than the Lord, were uncomfortable with her just walking in on this. For her to walk in knowing that Jesus was there had to take a lot on her part. Did you ever have a party and an uninvited guest comes in? You know how that, you know, be a little uncomfortable? Well, it's also uncomfortable, usually, in some cases, for the person that's not invited and comes in anyway. She must have heard something Jesus spoke about that caused her to do this. She must have heard him talk something, or at least heard of things he was saying, for her to take this kind of a chance. She must have believed that Jesus could heal her brokenness and be able to make her whole. That God could still do something wonderful with the pieces of her life. Just think. She would never have been invited to this or any other gathering. She would never have been invited. But she walks in anyway. This was not a safe place for her. This was not a safe move. But she felt compelled to chance whatever may happen. She had to see Jesus. She was desperate. For those gathered for this meal, she was broken beyond repair. A Pharisee would see someone who was a throwaway. But she hoped and she trusted that that's not how Jesus would see her. What she does next, those gathered for this meal at Simon's house must have felt embarrassed. It was inappropriate. It's unacceptable. Jesus is reclining at the table and this woman approaches. She stands at the feet of the Lord. All eyes in that room are no doubt on her. She probably feels the stares of condemnation. Not Jesus. She looks at Jesus and he knows what's in her heart. He feels her hurt, her utter despair, her brokenness, her desperation. She knows there is hope in what Jesus has been saying and what Jesus has been doing. It's like this is her last chance for help. She's so desperate. She breaks down and begins to cry. Not simply sobbing, but an all-out release of her inner self. So much so that her tears are just pouring, they're flowing. They pour from deep within her soul. She is so heartbroken that she falls to the ground and she begins to kiss the feet of Jesus. Can you picture that? She had to feel that she was utterly worthless, that she was no better than the dirt on the Lord's feet. She notices that his feet haven't been washed as customary. It has been said that oftentimes it's only when tears fill our eyes can finally see things clearly. She doesn't have a towel, and she certainly can't ask for one. So she lets down her hair. Now we may overlook this, but back then, a woman would only let her hair down in the privacy of her home. She lets her hair down, care. Her tears are wetting the feet of Jesus, and she wipes them with her hair. All the while her tears continue to flow. Her soul is pouring out. Her heart is pouring through those tears. She then takes a small bottle of perfume that she has around her neck and pours all of it on the feet of Jesus. Those little bottles of perfume would be used sparingly because they were of value. And she just pours the whole bottle on Jesus' feet. She was broken. She felt no way out, hoping that Jesus could help her to escape her life of despair. She was now putting her life in the hands of the Lord. By Jesus allowing this to happen, he was saying to her and those gathered that this was a beautiful act, what this woman was doing. He sees her brokenness as beautiful. In this story, we see what Jesus does. He flips conventional wisdom on its ear. He rebukes Simon, who was following all the rules, and lifts up this sinner, this broken woman that most would just cast off as a throwaway, a nobody, somebody that's worthless. This story in Luke ends with Jesus saying in verse 48, "Your sins are forgiven." And then in verse 50 he says, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Not go in peaceless, but go in peace." And she is made whole. Just think how she must have felt. So much different than those that were gathered there. Their feeling toward this episode and her feeling. He flipped things upside down. So let me ask, who would you rather be in this story? Simon, who seemed to have it all together? Or would you rather be this woman who is a broken mess, but experienced the love and the grace of Jesus in such a deep, deep way? Jesus said, "I am the door." We should see that door as the door mark for the broken. What can we learn from this story? If we want to know the love and the grace of Jesus in a deep way, if we want value and purpose for our lives, it only comes through brokenness. And so the point of this morning's sermon is this. The point of the sermon is brokenness. We need to stop trying to hide it. We need to stop trying to pretend like all the pieces fit together. Instead, we must admit to ourselves and to God that we are broken and in dire need of God's grace. Praying to God that those are the broken pieces of my life, and I so much need you to mend me, put me together, keep me together, make me whole. Okay, now what do we do with this? Do we try to keep hiding our brokenness? It's almost human instinct to hide our true selves. We feel like it's a matter of self-preservation. We don't want to look weak. Any little kid knows what to do when he breaks something. Hide it and hope nobody finds out about it. Are we as adults any different? Hiding our brokenness is not the answer. The answer is to admit it, to face it, and to take it to Jesus, just as this woman did. It is only then that we can be made whole. That we will have the peace that passes all understanding that Jesus talks about. Now there is good news. The good news is Jesus came to make us whole. The good news is God makes the broken whole through Jesus the Christ. An example of how this works is we find in Isaiah 53, verse 5. Isaiah 53, 5. But Jesus was wounded for the wrong we did. He was crushed for the evil we did. The punishment which made us well was given to him. And we are healed because of his wounds. What Isaiah is saying here is we are made whole because Jesus was broken. Jeremiah speaks of this as well, Jeremiah 18, 1 through 5. In these verses, Jeremiah is instructed by the Lord to go to the potter's house, and there God will give him words. We're told that Jeremiah observed that the potter was making a jar, and it became flawed. So he began to make something different from the pieces that were left. God says, and I'm paraphrasing, I know the people are broken, and just like the potter, I will make them into something beautiful. So here's one more example. Back in the 1500s, the Japanese began the art of kintsugi, if I'm pronouncing that right. Kintsugi is the art of taking broken pieces of ceramic tile and sealing them back together using gold. Instead of hiding the cracks of where the objects were broken, the cracks are highlighted. And here's what happens. The value goes up. This is what God does for us and to us. We're all broken. We all have cracks. And we all try to hide them. Those very things that overwhelm us, those things that we are most afraid of, those things that we keep secret, the things we most want to be done with, those are our cracks. Those are the cracks. And God wants to put the pieces back together into a more valuable vessel, a more beautiful one, one made in the image of God, one fit for his kingdom. Let's pray. We thank you, Lord, that you allow us to call you Father. Father, in these next few moments, allow us as a family just to stop pretending and to admit our brokenness and to recognize that our brokenness, that through in our brokenness, you have the power to make us whole. Lord, we know that right now, some of us want to hold our broken pieces back, to hide them deep from not only ourselves and others, but from you. That we don't want to talk about them or think about them. We know that you are just waiting for us. You're waiting for us to bring them forward to your throne. That just as a potter, you will make us a vessel of value. We ask, Father, that you take our broken pieces and make something new that seems right to you. Help us to realize that through what you would have us be, your power and your grace and your love will be on full display. Father, we find confidence and hope through your word and the words of our Lord Jesus when he said to the woman, your sins are forgiven. May we, like her, fall on our knees at the feet of Jesus and empty ourselves before him and trust that you will refill us with your love, your forgiveness, and that peace that passes all understanding, that you will make of us a vessel of value fit for your kingdom. In our Lord's name, amen. Thank you, everyone, for your attendance this morning. Brian's about to lead us in a song. We call it a song of invitation. That's for anyone here that's today that has yet to accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. As we sing the song, won't you come forward and we'll help you on that walk. Let the Lord put your pieces of your broken life back together. You will become a more valuable vessel than you ever thought. Thank you.
Yeah. Quicker work that time. You never know what's going to work.